Hello my friends, welcome again to my video channel. Today we will start a new project. No, not another repair video or restoration video. We will create a high voltage power supply. In my lab here on my workbench, I can generate maximum of 200 volt DC with some power, not more. I have a smaller unit, up to 2 kV, but it supplies only 1 milliamp or so. What I want, together with a friend of mine, he also had the same idea, we discussed it, to generate a power supply in the range of 400, 500 volt DC, 100, 200 milliamps, depending upon the transformer. This is useful when working on tube gear, where we need a rather high B plus and maybe an auxiliary voltage C minus also, but the main topic is the B plus with 400 volt is my first estimation to generate. Then we can operate on tube gears. That's a main topic. There is a unit on the market, an old Heathkit IP17. It's a tube power supply supplying I think 400 volt DC with 100 or 120 milliamps, but this is hard to get, hard to obtain, and the prices are beyond any reasonable discussion. When the price is cheap, the unit is slaughtered, and when the unit is operating or near operating status, where there's a good chance to repair it, the price is beyond any reasonable discussion. Today we can generate such a high voltage rather easily with power MOSFETs, linear power supply. I'm not talking about switched mode power supply. I'm talking about linear power supply. But first of all, a very, very important hint. High voltages are lethal. Take it seriously. A mistake, an error, is not forgiven. It's your first and your last error. DC, we are talking about DC, is much more dangerous or lethal than AC. AC has a zero crossing, and there's a chance that you can disconnect yourself from the power supply. DC has no zero crossings, and DC voltages above 60 volt DC can be lethal. Okay, 60 volt DC is not so lethal as 600 volt DC, but we are talking here in our project about voltages of 400, maybe 500 volt DC. Never forget this sentence. In my projects up to now, I did not make any safety hint, because it's obvious when you are working in a operating equipment which is supplied by a 230 volt AC from the lines, then it is dangerous. But here I say it again, high voltages are absolutely lethal. If you are not working on such high voltages or did not work on such high voltages up to now, keep your fingers off this project. Watch it, but do not try to build it. You will make an error and you will be killed. Don't forget this. And now let's start. This is a part of the schematic of the IP17. Look in the net for Heathkit IP17 and manual, and you will find this schematic. Here's a secondary winding, 210 volt AC. This voltage is doubled because the positive voltage charges up this capacitor and the negative half wave charges up this capacitor. So when we have 210 volt AC times root 2, we come to 290 up to 300 volt peak, and then we have here 600 volt between here and here, and the output voltage specified is up to 400 volt. Okay, it will be a little bit lower under load condition, of course. These two tubes here are in parallel. This is a linear regulation, and these two tubes are controlled on their grids here from V3. And here's the feedback. The output voltage is fed to the grid of V3. When this voltage is too high, then this tube gets conductive and draws down the grid of these two tubes, and then the output voltage drops. So this is a negative feedback to stabilize the output of this circuit. There's a B plus setting on the front. Here is a meter circuit, ampere meter, voltmeter. And these are two negative voltages that are necessary for the tube V3, because V3 needs a negative bias to get operative. And on the other hand, the cathode also has to be negative to make sure that we can reduce the voltage on the anode to zero. So we have here a negative cathode voltage, but for the grid we need a more negative voltage. So we have here a second negative voltage, minus 150, minus 300, and this negative voltage is fed to the voltage divider. So it is possible that depending on the setting of the wiper here, we get a voltage which can block this diode V3. V3 needs, again, a negative voltage to be blocked and to have the linear setting range of the circuit. Otherwise, if we don't have a negative voltage here related to the cathode, then this triode is always conductive. It's a pentode, sorry, but I see it only as a triode to stabilize the output voltage. This negative feedback here requires, due to this reason, the negative auxiliary voltage here to go down in the output to zero. What we have here, what I don't like, we have no current limitation, any short circuit here. I don't know what really happens, how good the tubes are, whether they will survive or not. I really don't know. I will not reconstruct the circuit here. And the second problem is the tubes are in parallel, but there are no resistors here in the cathode or in the anode to make sure that both have the same current. So when they are aging over the years, maybe one of these two tubes is drawing more current than the other one. And this is not nice. There should be stabilization resistors to avoid this, to prevent this, but okay, it's a design from Heathkit, and it is as it is. The auxiliary voltages here, negative voltages, is also used for C minus bus for, it's a high ohmic output voltage only for control grids or so. This part here is needed for the screen grid SIC to generate a positive voltage. This is also a rectifier. Here we have some output for the 6.3 volt for the tubes. Okay, the main part is this one here, and this one we will try to reconstruct with power MOSFETs, with N-channel power MOSFETs. They are available on the market today for €1 or €2, and they are rated up to 800 volt DC and thermal dissipation of 40, 50 watts or more on a heatsink. So it's rather easy to make it, to construct it with such power transistors. And here we have the first sketch, version 0.1 of such a circuit with power FETs, power MOSFETs. I've chosen the type BUZ80. I have a bunch of them in one of my boxes from an earlier, much earlier project some years ago, I think 10 years ago or so. They are still available on the market, but I will not use them due to isolation problems. But that's another topic. We see here the input voltage. But the rectifier and the transformer is not shown. Let me say we use 400 volt here or so. This is the linear stabilizer Q1. Source and drain, and on the gate we have here positive voltage, which makes it conductive. By the way, these transistors need a positive voltage on the gate related to source of 1, 2, or 3 volt to get fully conductive, and not as tubes who need a negative voltage. They accept a positive voltage here, but that's not the main problem. We have here the same feedback loop. The output voltage is fed to this Q5. And when the output voltage gets higher, as said here, then this transistor gets conductive and draws the gate down. This source also has a negative voltage. I've chosen here minus 12 volt for my first tests. And this part here has minus 24 volt DC. And here I need a negative auxiliary supply, 30, 35 volt, not more. This is the first test circuit to see how it works. With this pot, I can set the output voltage between zero and full voltage, which is coming in here. This is only a load, a minimum load. It's always necessary when we have a linear regulation that we have a minimum load on the capacitor to avoid any oscillations. This is a very simple circuit. First testing the principle of this circuit here. And to test it. By the way, all schematics I will publish on my website. I will give the link in one of the following videos when we have a little bit more information and more circuits to discuss about it. Then I will do it so you can rebuild it again. It's up to you. This is the first test setup. Quick, dirty, ugly, but it works. This is a transistor. Don't fear, the voltage is only 30 volt here. I don't have here 400 volts. I'm using 30 volts. I can show it. Full scale is 50 volt. The feed-in voltage is 30 volt. And here we have a negative voltage of minus 30 volt, which is necessary for the two Zener diodes here. This is minus 30 volt. I do not operate it in the first check with full voltage. Here we have the linear regulator with the output here with the load. And here's the second transistor with the pot here. And now I will connect the voltmeter to the output voltage, which is in the moment zero. And I can tune with this pot the output voltage between zero and nearly 30 volts. Okay, in this 50% of the setting range here, nothing happens. I will align the resistors better. And here I can go down to zero when the wiper is on the top, very close to this output, and the feedback voltage is maximum. That means the output voltage is drawn down to zero. We have here negative auxiliary supply. And when the, it is really a little bit negative. You can see it here. The reason is that the negative voltage here is fed through these resistors to the output. And here we can increase the voltage to maximum. And now we will check the stabilization, how good the feedback operates to stabilize the output. I have here a resistor, 56 ohms, 5 watts. In this setting range here, the output is not regulated because the feedback is beyond the setting range. And when I connect this resistor to the output, you see the voltage drops a little bit. This is due to the fact that we have here a small series resistor and we have no stabilization. But when I go down to the range where the stabilization occurs, I go to 25 volt. This is here 25 volt. And when I add this resistor, this is 25, 56, is half an amp. Nearly nothing happens. We have good stabilization. This is a good sign. Yeah, it gets warm. It has only 5 watts. Half an amp at 25 volt is 12 watt. Okay, I have to be careful. We see that in the principle we are on the right way for stabilization. And then we go down in the voltage to this value to 5 volt, but I have to look for a different resistor. I have to look for 10 ohm to load it. Now I've set the output voltage. This is 10 volt full scale to 5 volt. I will try to adjust it perfectly. This pot is not the best for this purpose, but I want only to show you the stabilization. This is 10 ohm. I think 10 watt or so. I do it, use it only for some seconds, and when I add this resistor in parallel, it moves a little bit. Maybe you can see it. I see it on the ammeter of my power supply. The current is approximately half an amp, 0.5 amps. That's okay. So we see that the stabilization is rather good, and we do not produce half an amp with this circuit. In reality, it is limited to 150 milliamps or so, not more. So I think when we are in the higher voltage range, we can use this circuit for stabilization, and we do not need another amplification, the feedback loop. This transistor is good enough, has enough gain, forward gain, to do the job. And our goal is not to have a perfect stabilization, because when we look into the reality of tube gear, we have a power transformer, we have a rectifier cap, that's it, and some resistors in series. The stabilization of this circuit is not so good in reality, so I think this one here will be much better than the real power supplies in tube gears, so we can live with it. The goal here is not to have a perfect stabilization. It's necessary to have a stabilization, of course, but we will not over-engineer it. And over-engineering here makes no sense. One of my goals here is to keep it simple and stupid. KISS, keep it simple and stupid, and not to over-engineer it. Okay, we've seen such a circuit can work. It's rather easy, not so complicated. This is the end of part one. We make some short videos, not very big videos. In part two, we will increase the supply voltage here to a maximum of 200 volt DC and see what happens, whether we can work with it also. And then we will look for a short circuit limitation, which is necessary in such a circuit to avoid damage to the transistors and other components. And don't forget, stay tuned, stay healthy, and stay alive. See you on this channel.